Welcome to this week's story update. Today we're going to talk to Nicholas Deroose, who now lives in Singapore. We filmed his story 11 years ago this month. But before we talk to Nick, let's take a look at his story.
So my name is Nicholas Deroose, and I'm from Singapore. And my story is sort of how I came out in the military. And when I mean the military, it is the military in Singapore where I was born. So when every sort of male hits the age of 18, you usually have to enlist in the military for national service. What happens, you know, when it comes to being gay in the military is sort of not like America, where they have don't ask, don't tell. In Singapore, they will ask you. And they have this list they run through. Do you have any history of lung diseases? Do you have heart diseases? Blah, 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 so on and so forth. And then they ask you, do you have any mental disorders, i.e. homosexuality? So that is sort of the tipping point, whether you tell them you're homosexual or you don't. People usually don't declare. So I didn't declare as well, and I went through sort of start off in basic military training school. I was called in to see my commanding officer and stuff like that, and he sat me down and he says like, do you know why you're here? And I'll say, I don't know, why am I here? And he says, well, you know, I've heard some rumors about you and I want to find out if they're true or not. I ask him, what are those rumors? And he says, well, I heard that you're gay. You know, is this true? And I ask him, you know, why is this an issue? You know, is this, and honestly, at that point, I was like prepared for anything. I was like, I was gonna get court-martialed. I was like so sure of it. But really, I mean, his answer really surprised me, because he said that, well, I was wondering, you know, in case, you know, you were uncomfortable staying in the bunk with the boys. I don't think to myself, you have no idea how far you're from the truth. You have no idea. So, I mean, his answer was really surprising, because you think it was going to be like really negative and stuff like that, but it was actually coming from a place that was really supportive. We fear that we have to use the worst place scenario on our minds, but sometimes I think that we need to learn to trust people. And, you know, we may get hurt, you know, along the way, but that makes us stronger. And if we take that risk, we also reap a greater reward.
All right, welcome, Nicholas. How are you? How's it going?
Yeah, it's good. It's sunny here in Singapore, and that video was quite the throwback, really. I hardly recognize myself.
How many hours ahead are you?
It's morning here in Singapore, and I think we are about 12 or 13 hours ahead of you guys, if I'm not mistaken. Yeah.
Okay, well, thanks for finding the time to do this. I'm glad it worked out. So can you give us just a very general update on your life right now? What's going on? You know, how's life? You moved from Philadelphia to Singapore. Just kind of give us an overview of what's new with you.
So after I graduated, I came back and, like any fresh grad, you know, I looked for a job, you know, managed to get a job pretty easily. So I think I was pretty fortunate, because, you know, at a time when, you know, I was graduating, I was, you know, a bit worried that I wouldn't be able to get a job. And, you know, after, you know, my career kind of like stabilized, you know, I then kind of threw myself back into, you know, queer activism again, you know what I mean? Because I was, you know, involved in Philadelphia. After I returned, you know, to Singapore, you know, that work continued. And I started up a podcast with a friend of mine, we'll continue to revive this podcast, basically. Called QueerCast, and the idea around, you know, QueerCast was to focus on the Asia region and the kind of, you know, queer advancements or queer challenges that were sort of happening in Asia. So, you know, some examples would be, you know, sort of, you know, what is it like, you know, for gay life in Japan? If you are a foreigner, you know, coming to Japan, you know, how do you fit into gay life in Japan? The others would be, you know, talking to the people behind the civil rights movement in Hong Kong. Hong Kong, again, recently has been very much in the news because of, you know, this new national security law. And, you know, a lot of the civil rights groups there are very worried about, you know, how this law will impact them. And, you know, and what it means to continue to be an activist in Hong Kong. And last, but certainly not least, you know, the sort of road to marriage equality in Taiwan. And Taiwan really has been kind of leading the way in terms of, you know, LGBT rights here in Asia. You know, they just legalized, you know, they just had marriage equality not too long ago, and the fight continues in Taiwan. Closer to home, here in Singapore, you know, we just this March of this year, the courts rejected three separate legal challenges to Section 377A. And Section 377A basically is the penal code that criminalizes sex between men. So effectively, you know, homosexuality is illegal in Singapore. And, you know, that law basically then, you know, trickles down, you know, to all sorts of other effects here in the queer community, whether that be discrimination, violence, exclusion, you know, and so that has a lot of trickle-down effects. Having said that, you know, even though the legal environment is not ideal, you know, the community here in Singapore continues to be very resilient and continues to be focused on really creating internal resources in order to help the community. So one of the things that I'm most proud of, you know, my time here in getting involved in the queer community is sort of helping to fundraise and publish, you know, Singapore's first LGBT legal guide for families and couples. And so how that started on was that, you know, I was approached by a friend, you know, I think it was 2016. And she, you know, she came to me and she said that, you know, even though, you know, the law has not moved on, you know, people's lives, you know, don't stay still. You know, queer people in Singapore want to have families, want to have long-term relationships, want to have legal protections, you know, so how can we do that in this climate whereby the law is still very much, you know, has not been in favor of queer people? And so, you know, she gathered this group of 18 other lawyers and basically sort of collated community law in Singapore, so the existing law in Singapore, and then applied that to situations that, you know, couples or families might face. So this is in relation to things like, you know, immigration, visitation rights, adoption, you know, the difference between, you know, how to negotiate, how to sort of navigate Sharia law here in, you know, and all that, you know. So it was, I think, you know, on the team's part, a really sort of tremendous effort to get this guide pushed out. And I still remember sort of doing the fundraising process, you know, the moment we launched our fundraising campaign, you know, within 48 hours, the entire thing was funded. And I think that
Wow.
our goal was, you know, $10,000. And I think that our final amount was, you know, close to just over $20,000. And so there's this outpouring of support for this resources, this kind of resource, because I believe that queer people are ready to sort of want to move their lives forward and want to have, you know, a more kind of legalized relationship in Singapore. Unfortunately, you know, the ruling party in Singapore is maintaining that status quo. And that's what's really sort of preventing, you know, sort of the advancement of gay rights here in Singapore. So, you know, that was in 2017. Another sort of very sort of prominent, you know, point to note in sort of the queer history here in Singapore is the sort of the continued sort of attendance or the continuing parade basically of Pink Dot. And basically, for people that do not know what Pink Dot is, it's kind of like, you know, Singapore's version of a pride parade. And I say it's kind of like a pride parade because it is not really a pride parade in a sort of a US kind of Western kind of context where you have sort of these large floats going down the street and, you know, all these dancers and stuff like that. In Singapore, you know, that does not happen. You know what I mean? And the one of the main reasons being is that because, you know, we have a kind of constricted freedom of assembly. So if you want to protest, you know, there is only one place in Singapore where you can do so, and it's a park. So you apply for a police permit, and then you're allowed to protest at this park in the center of the city. And so for gay people, this is the only available space as well to hold, you know, such a protest. You know, so Pink Dot, you know, continues, you know, to start to raise the level of awareness and visibility, you know, for the queer community here in Singapore. And I think that's also very encouraging. But this year, obviously, it's very different. You know, I mean, Pink Dot typically happens in June along with the rest of Pride season. But because of the COVID-19 situation, you know, you can't have large gatherings. And, you know, Pink Dot typically attracts about 30,000 people at the park. So, you know, I mean, so they decided, the organizers then decided to have basically an online show. But I thought what was really great about this year's online show was the sort of, you know, the diversity of issues that were represented. What I was most impressed about was sort of the visibility of trans or non-binary, trans or non-binary teenagers in Singapore. You know what I mean? So, you know, you have this, you know, the trans community here as well, you know, that you don't often see, you know, because like I said, you know, sometimes, you know, that image is, you know, very so often, you know, dominated by, you know, gay men. But the trans community here, you know, exists as well, because we all know that, you know, trans people, you know, may not necessarily be able to pass in society. So they are subjected to, you know, the most amount of violence, you know, or discrimination wherever they go. You know what I mean? So, you know, I think increasingly the community here in Singapore is also, you know, focusing a lot of attention to the trans community. You know, we have, you know, I think that in Singapore, you know, even though we still have Section 377 on the books, you know, what I'm most proud of is that we actually have a trans shelter. So the T Project really was started up by these this transgender activist, and you know, the community really rallied around here to build this shelter because they realized that this is a very much needed resource. You know, because I think increasingly the community is waking up to understanding that, you know, the trans community is very much, you know, at threat of violence, at threat of discrimination, and the legal system or, you know, the government as a whole will not be supporting this community. So I think what I'm most proud of is really sort of, you know, the resilience of the community, how they continue to operate in an environment that isn't welcoming of them, and how their creativity really shines through, and also how the community has also rallied around the trans community here in Singapore.
It kind of seems like society and the queer community and even the straight community is kind of moving along and moving forward to a better place, and the government is lagging behind a little bit. Is that sort of an accurate takeaway from that?
So it kind of is and is not. So, you know, I think that we need, as a community, what we're lacking really is statistics, right? You know, we need to be able to sort of pull people out there, say that, okay, what are their shifting attitudes towards, you know, LGBT issues? And I don't know the figures on the top of my head, but I think there was a survey commissioned by a think tank here in Singapore. And, you know, increasingly younger people are more accepting, you know, they understand, you know, what LGBT issues are, they understand what it means to be queer in Singapore. But, you know, we have, you know, still a very conservative population here in Singapore, very much backed by, you know, religion. The kind of, I would say, you know, Christian presence in Singapore is very large and also very rich. You know what I mean? And that gives them a lot of, you know, lobbying power and, you know, allows them to, you know, be able to use those funds to, you know, basically further their message. Yeah.
So if you are a, you talked about so many different queer causes and activists, and if you are a queer person in Singapore, I guess it's two questions. One, in Singapore specifically, the other one, a queer person in Asia, since you touched upon the other countries in Asia. Where should they go? What if they're looking for a community? What if they're looking for resources? Mm-hmm. Do you know specific police organizations that you can refer people to?
Oh, absolutely. So, you know, in Singapore, you know, when we set up the, when we published the legal guide, basically, you know, we had a website. So you go to www.singaporelgbtlaw.com, you will find a resource page. The guide is also available for free to download, so you can have that as well. In Singapore, you know, like I said, you know, even though we have an environment that is homophobic, you know, we still have this sort of very thriving gay community. You know what I mean? So I think that one of the resources that or groups that have been created recently is Out in SG. And so Out in SG really is this, you know, Singapore-based social group. And it was born out of the need to interact basically outside of the bars, right? So, you know, for a lot of the gay community, you know, bars or bathhouses are really kind of the way in which we enter into gay culture or meeting people online through the apps like Grindr and stuff like that. And, you know, there were people in the community that said that that has to be more. And so Out in SG was created to sort of, you know, have events that were in an environment that were not sexualized. I took it upon myself, you know, to sort of kind of to organize swimming in Singapore because, you know, I had been with the Philadelphia Finns, you know, and I wanted to really try to sort of recreate that kind of swimming community here in Singapore. So Out in SG is one. So, you know, it's welcoming of everybody, but it's predominantly, you know, gay men. For, you know, for women, you know, the main organization here is Sayoni. And Sayoni, you know, has a whole host of, you know, services under them, you know, counseling, support, and stuff like that. In fact, I really want to highlight Sayoni as an organization because just last year, Sayoni sort of did research and interviewed close to 40 women here in Singapore to compile a report on, you know, violence and discrimination against queer women here in Singapore. And I think that, you know, having that physical book with all those interviews and statistics, you know, really is basically concrete evidence, you know. And I think that having this kind of concrete evidence is very important, especially when you are trying to sort of, you know, advocate for your case. For the trans community in Singapore, the main organization here is the T Project. It's also sort of the same organization that is was behind the homeless shelter. You know what I mean? So the T Project continues to, you know, advocate for the trans community here in Singapore. They provide counseling services. They, you know, there's shelter, you know, they provide, you know, resources in terms of books and stuff like that. Fun fact, Singapore actually was one of the first few, was actually the place where the gender reassignment surgery was pioneered. So, you know, in the beginning, you know, you had, you know, these doctors that were performing all these gender reassignment surgeries, you know what I mean? But because, you know, slowly after that, you know, you had sort of all these kind of like religious influences, and then, you know, that sort of kind of shifted away. And now for a lot of the trans community that want to transition, you know, they usually go up to Thailand.
So I have one more question because we're just about out of time. And I wanted to take it back to the story that you shared with us 11 years ago, because at the very end, I think you said something really nice. And I'm curious as to if you still believe it, which I imagine you will, but kind of your thoughts on that. You talked about the importance of just being being honest and, you know, thinking that it's much safer to be quiet and to yourself, but to take risks, you know, because you had a lot to lose, you know, by taking that risk, and you did. So what are your thoughts on that today? Do you still feel even more so now, or do you feel, you know, how do you feel about that?
I mean, you know, in terms of, you know, being honest with yourself, I think, you know, when I was looking back and, you know, I was definitely a lot more fearless, you know, when I was young, you know what I mean? Really kind of like balls to the wind or whatever the case is. You know, and, you know, over time, you know, when I was, and I speak to a lot of young people, you know, and my interactions with them, you know, I always also advocate, you know, for safety. Yes, it is very, it's important to be honest with yourself, but it's also sort of, you know, you really have to also sort of negotiate that with safety. You know, if a lot of the kids who are thinking of coming out here in Singapore, you know, they're still very much living with their parents, you know, they still have a lot of financial ties to them, you know. And so, you know, I think that, you know, coming out continues to be a journey. And, you know, you don't just come out once, you know what I mean? You come out many, many times. You come out to yourself, you come out to your friends, you come out to your family, you know what I mean? I think for a lot of gay men, I think our continuing challenge is with loneliness. And, you know, for many, many reasons, you know, we put up these defensive walls, or we feel that, you know, we can't be honest about the truth of who we are, whether it is to ourselves or to the outside world. You know what I mean? And so I think that, you know, the real prize that comes with honesty is to then be able to be vulnerable in front of someone else, and then be able to then open yourself up to love. You know, when I came back from the US, you know, I fell in love, basically. I count myself very fortunate to be able to find a partner that, you know, that loves me for who I am, and, you know, that, and we've been able to build a stable and long-lasting relationship in spite of the challenges, in spite of the climate. And I think a lot of that has to do with being honest with each other and being honest with yourself. So I'm happy to say that, you know, just last month, we celebrate our 9th anniversary together. And we are looking to, you know, build a home together this year. And so I wanna say that, you know, it will be tough to be queer in Singapore. And it certainly is not ideal, but it also isn't impossible. If you really want something, I think that you really will have to fight for it. But I think that, you know, love keeps you going.
That's great. Well, congratulations on your relationship. 9 years, that's, you know, that's shortly after we filmed your story. That's great. Well, thank you so much for taking the time. I know there's a big time difference, and I really appreciate you being flexible with that. So thanks again for your time. And we're going to, if anyone has any questions for Nicholas or being queer in Asia or Singapore, leave them in the comments, and Nicholas will ask that you periodically check back. And if you want to watch Nicholas's story, his full story is available on I'm From Driftwood, as well as thousands more on our Facebook and Instagram. So you can find them all there. Thanks for watching, and we'll check back in with you next week for next week's story update. Thanks.